Good morning. How are you this morning on this Sunday morning? How are you on this Mother's Day morning? Good morning to all of you. I just thank God for you. I hope that you had a great night's sleep and you are feeling well this morning, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and ready to worship, yes, and ready to hear the word of the Lord. Amen. I'm Valerie Oliver, senior pastor of First Liberty Baptist Church of Baton Rouge, Louisiana. But we are not your traditional Baptist church. We are not your typical Baptist church. And I am not your typical pastor. We are all inclusive. We welcome all. We want all to know, LGBTQ plus community, Asian, Black, White. We don't care what your background is, what your gender affections are, who you love, who you marry, straight, gay, whatever. Come on, this is God's house. Amen. This is God's house. We are what every church ought to be. And we welcome you this morning to our Sunday sermon. And listen, I tell you, the Lord has a word for you this morning. So you stay with me. Now listen, I want to wish all of the mothers out there a very happy Mother's Day. Oh, we thank God for you. You mothers who are loving, who are beautiful inside, who are caring, who accept your LGBTQ plus children, mothers who are supportive, we thank God for you. We love you. We thank God, and we just want to wish all of you, biological mothers, foster mothers, adoptive mothers, single mothers, married mothers, same-sex loving mothers, lesbian mothers, inclusive mothers, straight mothers, trans mothers. We want to just worship the Lord this morning and give God thanks for you. Don't you know that you are the love that is closest to the love of God that anyone can experience in this earth? Your love as a loving and caring mother is closest we can get to the love of God in this earth. And we thank God for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. So listen, y'all, we're going to move on in our worship experience. And of course, I want to share with you a worship song. We want you to let God speak to your heart. Some of you may be wondering where you are in life and why you aren't where you want to be or where you think you should be in life. This video will let you know, will remind you that the Lord knows where you are and the Lord has his hands on you. The Lord's hands are on you, beloved. Yahweh, Almighty Spirit, our Creator, God's hands, however you refer to God, God's hands are on you wherever you are. And so we are going to worship this morning, and then I'm going to come back and we're going to pray. Amen. I'll be right back.
A lot of us in this house tonight, we're on the Father's will right now. And it's not comfortable. It doesn't feel good. But we need to just take solace in the fact that even though it may not feel good right now, as long as I'm in his hands, I know that everything is going to be all right. Just touch somebody, look them in the face, and tell them I'm in his hands. Listen.
He sees
the tears
And he shared.
He shared your pain inside.
And sometimes.
Sometimes you wonder why he
allows you to go through
what you go through.
What you go through. Listen. Just know
he has his hands on you.
That's a good place to slip up those hands and give him some praise. Oh, I can't get no help in here. That's a good place to bless him. Listen, listen to the words. See your day. Even when the sun is up, yes it is. And from the top of your lungs,
you shout.
Oh,
will there ever
be a change? What shall I do? Can I tell you one thing? Remember, just know. Yes, it does.
He said,
I'll see you through. And when you cry, he's holding you. So just lift your hands up high, for he will. He will provide. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Just know he has his hand. Said, I'll see you through. And when you cry, he's holding you. So you can just lift those hands up. He will heal. He will provide. No. Just know he has.
His hand. Just know He has His hands on you.
Amen, beloved. You have to remember, God's hands are on you. God's hands are on you wherever you are. That was Marvin Sapp. He has His hands on you. So, beloved, now we're going to go ahead and pray. Listen, the Lord said, don't worry about your problems. Don't carry your burdens. The Lord said He'll see you through. The Lord Almighty, our Creator, Jehovah Jireh, our Provider, said, don't worry about anything. Just pray about everything. And so I want you to come on with me before the presence of God and lay your burdens down. The Lord said, you don't have to carry these burdens. Cast all of your burdens upon Me, for I care for you. And so we know that God is both willing and able. And so, beloved, without further ado, let us go on and pray. Dear God, most holy, gracious, most high God, we thank You this morning. We look to You, Lord, where all of our help comes from, all of our strength, all of our peace, all of our comfort. Nowhere else can it be found. No one can provide us with the blessings like You can. We come this morning with thanksgiving on our hearts, Lord, because we are thanking You for the many blessings You have so graciously bestowed upon us, Lord. You didn't have to do it, but in Your love and Your kindness and Your mercy, You have blessed us beyond what we can even imagine, things we don't even know about. Dangers seen and unseen You have protected us from and kept us from them, Lord, and we didn't even know it. We thank You, Lord, for being with us and having Your hand upon us, no matter where we are and when we're there. We thank You, Lord. And Lord, we want to thank You for our loving mothers, those who are still with us and those who have gone on to be with You. All their troubles over now. Oh yes, we miss them, especially on this day. But we thank You for them. And we know, Lord, that there'll come a day, just like You prepared a place for them, You prepared a place for us. And we'll see them. Oh, we'll know them when we see them, and we'll be together once again, never to say goodbye again. But we thank You for them, and we thank You for those who are still with us. All mothers, those who are not biological mothers, all those who are giving love and care and kindness to children who don't know a real mother, who don't know a biological mother, adoptive mothers, foster care mothers, those who are loving and caring, who take the role of a mother. We thank you, Lord. Those who show unconditional love to our children. We thank you, Lord, for them. We thank you. And now, Lord, we know that as good as you have been to us, there have still been times when we have fallen short. We have let you down and we have not loved one another. You said in your word, love does no harm. And perhaps we have said something or done something that has harmed someone in some way or another. Lord, forgive us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Let us be the bright lights in this dark world. This is a dark and evil and cruel world. But Lord, if you fill us with your Holy Spirit, we can be bright lights. We can be those people you use in this earth to bring comfort and joy to others and healing and inspiration and encouragement to others, Lord. Use us as instruments in your service. And we'll be ever so grateful, Lord. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your forgiveness. And now, Lord, whatever may be burdening someone, whatever heaviness may be resting upon someone's heart this morning, Lord, we ask that you would remove it, Lord, that you would give them comfort. There are many who are mourning the loss of loved one this morning. May it be to a sickness or a disease or violence in the streets, Lord. There is so much loss, but you know all about it. We ask that you would touch, comfort, let your healing power be at work in their hearts, even right now, Lord. Comfort them as only you can. Give them strength. Give them peace that passes all human understanding. And Lord, there may be some other problem. There are those who are still struggling to keep a roof over their heads. There are those who are still struggling looking for a job. There are those who are still struggling one way or another. We are still not out of the pandemic. There are those struggling, Lord, with whether they should even take the vaccine or not. Lord, you touch their hearts and you lead them in the direction you would have them go. And Lord, we know whatever the situation may be, finances, marriage issues, relationship problems, problems on the job for those who are blessed enough to still have a job. Lord, fix it. We know you can, and we know you're willing. We'll wait, Lord, on your timing and your own way. And Lord, now as we approach your word, we ask, Lord, that we would approach it with open hearts. Give us spiritual ears to hear what you have to say to us this morning. Use me now, Lord, as you will. I must decrease and you increase. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. It is in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, we pray. Amen. Amen, amen. Listen, beloved, God is not only a prayer hearing God, but God is a prayer answering God. And so, beloved, we want you to go away knowing that God has heard your prayers and that God does answer our prayers. I want to say good morning again and happy Mother's Day, Sister Chloe, Roz, and Cheryl, all of you. YouTube family, Facebook family, welcome. And I can't see you all, but I love you and I thank you for being here with me this morning and whenever you watch. And so listen here. Today is May 9th, 2021, approximately 11:22 a.m. Why am I saying this to you? Why am I telling you what day it is and what time it is and what the date is? Because sometimes, beloved, we are so concerned about getting somewhere else in life. We are so concerned about where we want to go that we forget to embrace where we are. We forget to embrace where we are right now. We forget to enjoy where we are now because we're so busy thinking about where we want to be. But I stopped by to tell you this morning, beloved, that wherever you are, God is. Wherever you are, God is right there with you. Wherever you are in life, I know that sometimes you may feel like you should be further along in life than where you are right now. You might feel like you haven't accomplished everything you want to accomplish and that you should have accomplished this by now or that by now. You should be married by now. You should have children by now. You should have your dream home by now, your dream car. You should be somewhere else other than where you are right now. But beloved, let me remind you that God knows exactly where you are. God knows where you are right now, and God knows where you want to be. Amen. God knows where you want to be, beloved. God knows what's in your heart. Listen, I want to share with you a passage very familiar to some of us. It's Acts, the 16th chapter, and I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. This is God's message to you this morning. Now, you stay with me. I'm going to Acts, the 16th chapter, and we're going to look at verses 25 through 30. And you know I read the NIV, so if you're used to the King James Version, it may read a little differently. And so Acts the 16th chapter, verses 25 through 30. Now, before we get there, beloved, let me give you a little bit of a background. Paul, the one who, when he was called Saul, was knocked off of that horse on his way to Damascus to persecute believers in Christ, to persecute those who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, and so on that way, the Lord dealt with Paul. And so this is the Paul I'm talking about. And by the time we get to Acts, the 16th chapter, Paul is on missionary journeys. The persecutor has become the persecuted. And now the persecutor is now turned into a worshiper of the true and living God and is preaching the gospel. Now, stick with me. And on one of his missionary journeys, he was joined by Silas. He was accompanied by another believer named Silas. And so Paul and Silas were together, and as they went on their way, they ran into a young girl who was making money. She was a slave girl. Ooh, there's some stuff I can say about that. This was a slave girl who was making money for those who were her owners, who were her slave owners, and she was making money for them by fortune telling. Now, that's verses 19 through 24. And so Paul and Silas was passing through there, and this girl started following them, and she started talking to them and saying things to them like, "You two are followers, servants of the Most High God." And she just kept on saying it and saying it and saying it. Beloved, how do you know, how many of you know that when somebody says something to you that's good and that sounds good, doesn't mean they're using it for the right motive? This girl here was a fortune teller, and let me tell you something, beloved. See, people get mad with me when I talk about this. Don't nobody know your future but God. Don't nobody know your future. Nobody knows the plan God has for you but God. And so, beloved, Paul had to shut this girl up and say, "Look, go on now," and told the demon to leave her. And so when the crowd found out that she could make no more money, because see, that's how she was doing it, by the power of a demon. I'm not going there. This is not the lesson. And so I'm giving you a little backdrop. And so when Paul and them cast the demon out of this girl and told them, "Look, just hush your mouth. Just hush your mouth." And so when the owners of this girl, this slave girl, the slave. See, because we become slaves of those we obey. Whether it's God or a demon, we become slaves. And so her slave owners got upset about it because she wasn't making money for them anymore. And so they decided that they were going to take Paul and Silas into custody. They took them before the magistrates. Those were judges, so to speak, in the Roman government. And they went and lied on them and told them they were starting all kind of confusion and causing problems. And they had them beaten and thrown into prison. They put them in the inner prison. We call it up there in Angola the dungeon. They put them in the inner prison, the jail inside the jail. And so they shackled them. They shackled them, their hands and their feet. And so, beloved, this is where we are now in our text, verse 25. They sitting in prison, shackled for doing what? Nothing. Something good. Preaching the gospel, casting a demon out. See, people don't like when you're doing good and when you casting out demons and when you setting people free. They don't like that because they like to do it their way. They like to tamper with darkness and do things their way and all this kind of stuff. But beloved, that's fine. That's a choice that people make. But they got mad at Paul and Silas, and now here they are sitting in prison. Mm-hmm. And by now, when we get to verse 25, it is midnight. It is midnight. And what are Paul and Silas doing at midnight in prison? They are praying and singing hymns to God. See, beloved, prayer is fellowship with God. Prayer is communication with God. Prayer is talking to the Lord, and you are in God's presence. You and God are hanging out together when you're praying, beloved. And soon you're gonna break out with joy. You're gonna break into a praise. Paul and Silas were praying, and then they broke out into a praise. They started praising the Lord. The text tells us they went to sing it. Who in their right mind sitting in prison is praising God and singing praises unto the Lord? I tell you, whoever has a relationship with the Lord. That's right, Melissa, God bless you, sister, I see you praising the Lord. That's who, those of us who have a relationship with the Lord, beloved, the Lord will give you a song in the night. Whenever your midnight comes, whenever your night comes, the Lord will find a way to give you joy. You never know when your midnight is coming, beloved. That's why it's always good to know the Lord. And whenever your midnight comes, the Lord will be right there. The Lord will give you joy some kind of way. I don't know how God does it, but in the midst of it all, beloved, you'll be able to break out into a praise and throw your hands up and say, oh, thank you, Lord, when things are not even looking good, when things are looking unfavorable, you can still throw your hands up and say, hallelujah, thank you, Lord, I know you're doing something. That's called spirit over suffering. When the God in you is more powerful than what you're going through. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit and when the God in you is more powerful than what's going on in this world, greater is the one who is in you than him who is in the world. Whatever you're going through, beloved, I tell you, that spirit of God is a spirit of power. And that spirit of power will give you a victory over your suffering. Spirit over suffering. Hallelujah. And so Paul and Silas are praying and singing hymns unto God. Talking to God now. Talking to God. Let me pause for a moment right there. Talking to God now. Not the audience. Not the congregation. Not putting on a show. Not entertaining anybody. Not walking back across the stage. That's all right, long as you're doing it for God. But they're praising God. They're talking to the Lord. The scripture says that they sang praises unto God. Not to man, not to get claps and likes and amens from man and pats on the back from man, not to get the glory yourself, but singing to give God the glory. I know I'm right there. Yes, indeed. And so they were singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. The other prisoners, they were listening, you see, and probably wondering what's wrong with these dudes, you know. How can they be singing at a time like this? You know, beloved, people are watching you when you go through. When you go through something, people are watching you, especially if you go to church, especially if you say you read the Bible and you believe the Bible and you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ when your midnight comes, because just because you're in Christ does not mean you're not going to have a midnight. And when your midnight comes, beloved, don't you know that those who talk about you are going to watch you? They want to see how you're going to handle it. What you're going to do, you go around and you go to church every Sunday. You be sitting up in church and you watch church online and you pray all the time and you talk about how good God is. And they're going to watch you and see if God is really as good to you as you say. The prisoners were watching them. They were listening as they sang hymns to God. And suddenly, I'm in verse 26, suddenly there was a violent earthquake, so violent, beloved, that it shook the foundations of the prison. It was so violent that it shook the chains and the shackles off. The doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. Woo! Don't you know, beloved, that when you pray, God is right there. And sometimes before you even finish praying, the Lord has already answered your prayers. I know I'm right about it. Beloved, before you can get up off your knees, or even if you're not on your knees, before you can open your eyes, God has already answered your prayer. They are singing praises to God, and lo and behold, suddenly an earthquake, a violent earthquake. I imagine everybody looking around and wondering what in the world is going on, and the shackles come off, and the doors swing open. Beloved, the Lord will set you free. What are you bound to this morning? Come on now, look there. Be real with me. Let's be real in here. Some of us get bound to stuff. Some of us get so attached to things and it becomes habit, and sometimes it's not the most healthy habit. Some of us are bound to people we ought not be bound to. Some of us are shackled to certain drugs that are illegal because we are self-medicating. I understand it, beloved. Don't get me wrong. A lot of people I know in my work do that. They self-medicate. I try to get them to take medicine that's prescribed, beloved. You won't have to worry about me getting arrested, going to jail for having something illegal. Just go ahead and get your medicine. Ain't nothing wrong with taking medicine if you need it. And so, beloved, look here. Some of us are shackled by things. It could be too much alcohol. It could be money. It could be fame, popularity. Beloved, it could be addiction to gambling. Some of us are bound, beloved, but the Lord will set you free. Don't you know the Lord came to set us free? It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Nobody in Christ, nobody in God, nobody in the Lord ought to be bound. Nobody in the Lord ought to be shackled to something. The only one who ought to be ruling over us is God. The Holy Spirit ought to be the only one ruling and reigning in our lives. The earthquake shook them loose and set them free. And the jailer woke up. Now, he must have fallen asleep when Paul and Silas went to sing. Put him to sleep. And when he woke up during the earthquake, he saw that the prison doors were open. And he drew his sword. Now, Roman soldiers, they were some killers. They were some what they call them, OG? They were some real G, OG. He had his sword. And listen here, Roman soldiers knew how to look at you and tell that you were dead. They knew crucifixion like the back of their hands. You know, they were very skilled in what they did. And he drew his sword when he saw that the doors had slung open and he was about to kill himself. Why was he about to kill himself? Because Roman soldiers knew that if a prisoner escaped their custody, that was a death sentence. Uh-huh. See, today in prison, if you fall asleep and somebody escapes, and even if they don't escape, you just fall asleep and you got caught sleeping, you fired on the spot right there. Go home right now, and you'll be escorted off the prison ground. But they would be killed, the Roman soldiers. You get caught sleeping or somebody escape your custody, you got killed. And so the Roman soldiers drew his sword. He said, I'll just kill myself. I'm just gonna kill myself. I'm not gonna let them kill me. I'm just gonna go ahead and I'm gonna kill myself. And Paul shouted, don't harm yourself, brother. I added brother, you know. I paraphrase a lot, as y'all know, but it's still not taking anything away from the text. Paul said, don't harm yourself, brother. We are all here. We haven't escaped. We haven't gone anywhere. Don't kill yourself. Don't do that. We're here. We haven't gone anywhere. And the jailer said, turn the lights on. He called for lights. Turn the lights on. And look at what the jailer did. Now, hold on now. I know you wonder what in the world this have to do with me wanting to be somewhere else other than where I am. What does this have to do with me wanting to be more successful in life than where I am right now? Where do you think Paul and Silas wanted to be in prison? They didn't want to be where they were, but they made the best of it. Yeah, they went to singing and praising God. They made the best of it. They enjoyed where they were, even though it was an unfavorable vulnerable conditions, they embraced where they were and they still praised God because they knew they must be there for a reason. God must have let it happen for a reason. We stuck in here for some reason. I don't know what the Lord is doing, but guess what? We trust you, Lord. We praise your holy name. And so the jailer rushed in and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. Cut the lights on, he saw everybody was still there, you see. And Paul said, don't kill yourself. And so in verse 30, he brought out Paul and Silas. The other prisoners, they stayed there. They didn't go nowhere. They stayed. Must have been some power, some spirit of God that said, don't leave. Don't leave, because I don't want this jailer to be killed. And the Lord took care of them, trust me. The Lord took care of them. Because the Lord had something for this jailer. The Lord was going to bless this jailer. I don't want him killed. So the other prisoners stayed there. And the jailer brought out Paul and Silas. And he trembled before them. And he asked them, sirs, a term of respect. Sirs. First they were inmates, convicts. Well, that's how they talk to them. What you want, convict? You know? And so now the jailer, sirs, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? Now the jailer is at the mercy of Paul and Silas. How can I be saved, y'all? How can I have what you guys have? I saw you singing back there. What kind of power is that on you? How can you sing and rejoice in a time like this? I saw you, and now this? You've been set free. The shackles have fallen off. What must I do? I want to be like you. I want to know your God. Beloved, let me ask you a question. After people have been in your presence, what type of effect do you have on them? What type of effect do you leave on them? Do they want to know the God you serve after you've been in their presence? Or do they hope to never meet your God? Woo! Big people, listen here. Beloved, that's deep. That's deep right there. Because you know what? I don't want to be responsible for somebody not coming to the Lord because of me. Because of something I did. Because of something I said. Because of the way I treated them. You know what? I want to be able to say I did what the Lord told me to do. I said what the Lord told me to say. And if they mad about it, they'll be all right. That's between them and God. But I did what I was supposed to be. And so, beloved, how do people respond after having been in your presence? Do you draw them? Do you attract them to God? Do you attract them to the Lord Jesus Christ, beloved? Or do they turn around and say, see, that's why I don't go to church. See, that's why I don't worship Jesus. See that? That's what I'm talking about. You mean to tell me that's a believer? You mean to tell me that's how y'all act? I don't need to come in there to see that. That's how people in the street act. We're supposed to add flavor. Jesus said, you are the salt. You are the salt of the earth. You add flavor. When people come into your presence, beloved, they ought to want to come back again. When you go to Popeyes, I ain't been to Popeyes in some months now. I'm so glad about it. I've disciplined myself. I'm not going to Popeyes. Too much grease. All that grease. Y'all stop eating all that fried chicken. It's all right every now and then. But Popeyes will tell you when you come to the drive-in, when the welcome back. Welcome back to Popeyes. How may I help you? What can I get for you? because they know the chicken is good. They got it highly seasoned. Some of it is spicy. And oh, when the almighty chicken sandwich came out, they had people up fighting at the drive-thru about the chicken sandwich. And so listen, beloved, because it had flavor. And Jesus said, you, my disciples, you are the salt of the earth. You are my flavor in the earth. You draw people to me. So, are you giving sour, nasty taste, leaving a nasty taste in people's mouth? Or do you leave a flavor that attracts people and makes them want to come back and know the God you serve? The jailer asked Paul and Silas, what must I do to be saved? I want to be like y'all. Do people see God in you? Do people hear God in you? I'm not talking about just quoting scriptures. Anybody can go around quoting scriptures. Some of the most evil people in the world go around quoting scriptures. The devil knows the scriptures. But do you let the scriptures reign in your heart and rule in your life? Jesus said, the one who keeps my commands, that's the one who loves me. What are Jesus' commands? Nothing to love. Love God and love one another. That's all the commands we have. That's it. Love. Love does no harm. That's it. How easy is that? We don't have all them hundreds of laws and commandments they had in the Old Testament. You know, you couldn't even wear clothes that had different fabrics in them. If you planted a garden, you couldn't plant more than one type of vegetable in the garden. I'm talking about all kind of little bitty tedious laws. And the Lord knew all mankind couldn't keep all those laws. The Lord knew it. That's why he sent Jesus. That's why God, Almighty Creator, whoever we call God, that's why God, Almighty Spirit, sent Jesus, because the Lord knew we couldn't keep those commandments, all that stuff. Now, Jesus came and fulfilled all of the law. And Jesus said, if you love the Lord, your God, with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love one another as you love yourself, you have covered all of the law. You have covered everything. In the law and in the prophets. Love, beloved. Love does no harm. Love does no harm. That's how you know a good mother, a loving mother, they do no harm. Woo! And so, beloved, I ain't talking about just going around quoting scriptures. Anybody can do that. I'm talking about walking the walk, not just talking the talk. You got some who can talk a good game. I'm talking about having a relationship with Almighty God, a relationship that is so close and so powerful that it rubs off of you and onto other people. Don't you know that when you walk into a room, people can sense the presence of God on you? I'm almost through, beloved. People can sense the presence of God on you, and some will like it and some won't. The ones that don't like it, they're doing something in darkness. And they don't like that light. You see, they don't like that. They're doing something in darkness. And they don't like that light. And there's some people who won't want you around. They're not going to invite you to their parties. And guess what? You don't want to go. You don't want to go. Oh, that foolishness and stuff they be doing. Ain't nothing wrong with having a good time and having a select group of people who you accompany or who accompany you. People with some sense. People who know how to have fun, enjoy themselves responsibly. so they don't invite you? Good, because then I don't have to say no. You see? And so, beloved, they're not going to want you around because they can sense the presence of God on you. The scriptures tell us the Lord will be in you and with you and upon you. And people sense it. You walk in with a fragrance. Some people call it vibes. Some people call it energy. I call it spirit. I call it the power of God. And people can sense that when you walk in. They can sense whether you are of God and there's something about you. And some of them not going to like it. I tell you that. Some of them not going to like it, but some of them will. And some of them will see you as something favorable and adding flavor and attractive, drawing people to God. So let me go on, beloved. So listen here. God knew, beloved, exactly where Paul and Silas were. And they knew that God knew. They weren't worried about it. They were unbothered. They knew there had to be some reason. They were close enough to the Lord, and they knew the Lord well enough, and they had the Spirit of God ruling and reigning in their hearts so much so that they knew that there had to be a good reason why they were there. It wasn't a favorable situation, but they knew that there was a good reason, beloved, why the Lord had them there. There had to be. They trusted in the Lord because they had a relationship with God. Do you trust God this morning? No matter what you're going through, do you trust the Lord? No matter what situation you find yourself in at midnight, do you trust the Lord? Trust God. God is always God, and God is always good, no matter what happens. Paul and Silas weren't worried about it, you see. But the Lord knew where they were. The Lord knew they were in prison, in shackles. And in the same way, beloved, the Lord knows exactly where you are. The Lord knows exactly where you are in life, and the Lord knows exactly where you want to be. And the Lord wanted me to tell you this morning, don't worry about where you're trying to get to. It's okay. Make plans now. Go ahead and plan and make your preparations and prepare yourself for where you're going. But don't get disgusted with where you are. Enjoy where you are at the same time. Yeah, plan to reach your goals. Have some aspirations. But don't despise where you are. Paul and Silas were in the right place at the right time. They didn't despise being in prison. No, they didn't want to be there, but they didn't despise it. They knew the Lord was doing something. There must be something the Lord is doing. And beloved, the Lord knows right where you are. Right now. Don't despise where you are. Embrace where you are. The Lord is going to use you. Listen here. They replied to the jailer after they had asked, the jailer had asked Paul and Silas, what must I do to be saved? Paul and Silas said, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word. Now, hold on, I'm almost done as I come to a close. Listen here. They spoke the word of the Lord to the jailer. The jailer had invited them to his house. A prisoner going to a guard's house, a prison guard's house. That's the kind of flavor, see, that you have on people. That's the kind of power you have on people. See, that's the kind of attractiveness you have on people, people's presence, you know. You see what I'm saying? When you're in their presence. And yeah, he invited Paul and Silas to their house. And the jailer washed their wounds. See, they had them beaten. They had been all bloody and stuff, all up in the prison shackle and went to singing, all bloody. Ain't nobody but Jesus. And now he's taking care of them. And he brought them in the house, and he fed them. He washed their wounds, and he had something to eat. And everybody in the household got saved and got baptized. Oh, I see now why Paul and Silas were sitting in jail. The Lord had a blessing for the jailer, and not only the jailer, but his whole family. Oh, that's why they were there. Oh, Paul and Silas probably said to themselves, this is the reason the jailer wants to know how he can become a child of God. How can he have a relationship with God? How can I have what you fellas have? And Paul and Silas, it probably dawned on them. Ah, see now. You know, sometimes you'll look back, beloved, and you say, okay, I see. Now I understand. I didn't understand it then, but I understand it now. I see why I had to go through what I went through. I see why I was where I was and didn't want to be there. I understand it now. Because the Lord wanted to use Paul and Silas in that jail. Wherever you are right now, beloved, the Lord wants to use you. Wherever you are, you're in a job you don't like. You're in a situation you don't like. Wherever you are, beloved, the Lord wants to use you right there. And then you're going to move on. Don't despise where you are. Wherever you are in life right now, don't you know the Lord knows it? The Lord knows you're there. See what the Lord would have you to do while you're there. Embrace your right now. Embrace your here and now. And see what the Lord would have you to do. Don't be so focused on where you're trying to get to that you forget about where you are. The Lord has something for you. The Lord has something for someone around you. The Lord has something for the people who are watching you. Hallelujah. Be thankful, beloved. Even if it's not where you want to be right now, be thankful for where you are. And God is going to bless you and use you right where you are. Amen. God bless you, beloved. I hope that this message has blessed you. I hope that it has been an encouragement to you, beloved. I pray from the bottom of my heart. I know it is because the Lord gave it to me. It's not my words, it's the Lord's words. Amen, Ross and Cheryl. To God be the glory. You embrace your right now. It's all right. And beloved, before I go, I want to pause. And I want to extend to you the invitation to Christ. It's good to know the Lord. I know a lady used to say it all the time, I know the Lord and the Lord knows me. It's good to know the Lord because nights come. Night times come. Midnights come in our lives. Are you going to be praising God, singing and rejoicing? Or are you going to be falling apart, falling to pieces? You see, when you're in the Lord and the Lord has control of your life, I'm talking about the Jesus of righteousness, the Jesus of the Black Lives Matter movement, the Jesus of equality for all, including the LGBTQ+ community, the Jesus of justice. That's the Jesus I'm talking about. The Lord wants you to know him. The Lord wants you to have a relationship with Almighty God through Jesus. And if you have never met this Jesus, your time is now. If you have never met this Jesus, today, right now, is all you have. The past is gone and it will not come back. Tomorrow is not promised. But you have this very moment. It's the most important decision you will ever make in your entire life. And so, if you're coming to Jesus today, just pray. Lord, come on and show me what my purpose is. Come on, and I want to have a relationship with you. I want the power that you have for me. Because you said, greater are you in me than the one who is in the world and over any problem. Spirit over suffering. Come on, Jesus, I want to know you. And beloved, if you pray that prayer and you talk to the Lord, let us know. We want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. And when our doors swing open, couple of months, we're gonna wait till we hear from the Lord. But when the doors swing open, if you're in the area, come on and worship with us. Come on and worship with us. We are all inclusive. It's a safe place. Come on. Let us know. And so, beloved, I want you to know that I love you. Thank you for joining us. And listen here, I want you to have a great Mother's Day. I want you to be thankful. Whether your mother is still here or gone on to be with the Lord. The Lord knows what's going on. The Lord knows how you're feeling today. The Lord knows. But it's all right. And you can cry. That's okay. It's all right. But the Lord knows. Just know that the Lord knows. You're going to be all right. We're going to see him again. I'm not going to start talking about that because I keep you 30 more minutes. But love it. Go on and enjoy this day. Be thankful. Amen. And I'll look for you Thursday, 7 o'clock a.m. Central Standard Time for our Real Talk Inspiration. I want to see your face in the place. You bless my heart being here with me. I love you all. YouTube family, Facebook family, I love you. Once again, happy Mother's Day to you. If you are a loving, kind mother, you don't have to be a biological mother. Any mother you are, as long as you're loving and kind and caring and accepting, inclusive, not rejecting your children who are in the LGBTQ+ community. We thank God for you. And so, I'll see you next time, beloved. I love you from the very bottom of my heart. Thank you again so much for being here with me today. And so, you have a great day, and I will see you next time. God knows exactly where you are and where you want to be. Amen.